Blackstone Publishing presents Collected Stories by Saul Bellow. This book is read by Malcolm Hillgartner, Richard Poe, Kate Redding, Don Harvey, Robert Fass, Grover Gardner, Arthur Morey, Suzanne Toren, Donald Corren, Elisabeth Rodgers, Sean Runnette, and Joe Barrett.
Preface. Yesterday, my husband and I took our year-old daughter, Naomi Rose, for a stroll in the neighborhood. The weather was ferociously cold, what the forecasters in these parts unaccountably describe as blustery. To escape the icy wind, we headed for the Brookline Booksmith. Now, when Saul ducks into a bookstore, chances are he's going to be there for some time. I pulled Rosie out of her snowsuit and attempted to distract her with the dust jacket of Ravelstein. "Who's this, Naomi Rose? Who's the man in the picture?" And turning to point at Saul, she answered in that bell-like infant voice of hers that could be heard all through the store, "Dad! Dad! Dad!" Now, Dad was muffled in turtle fleece to the eyebrows, but his face emerged to give her a most delicious smile. This morning, as I begin to write, I imagine Rosie the reader, a couple of decades deeper into the century. When Rosie is ready for Saul's books, what memories will there be of Dad at his desk? And does memory need an assist? Will someone produce an accurate portrait of her father at work? Why not begin, I ask myself, with this little preface? To say for Rosie's sake, and for scores of others who will never see the man sitting down to write, this is how it was done. Proximity has been my privilege. I was there, for instance, when the Bella Rosa connection was born. It began innocently enough. In the first week of May 1988, en route from Chicago to Vermont, we stopped in Philadelphia, where Saul gave a lecture, a Jewish writer in America, for the Jewish Publication Society. In the weeks before he delivered his talk, and for the remainder of that month, during the drive from Philadelphia to Vermont, while exploring Dartmouth, where he was a visiting lecturer, and later in Vermont, where we were doing battle with the black flies to lay in a garden, our conversation was about nothing but the fate of the Jews in the 20th century. Just then, Saul was facing the final revisions on A Theft, and he was wrestling with A Case of Love, a novel he would never finish. Meanwhile, he was waiting to hear whether A Theft had been accepted by The New Yorker. Both Esquire and The Atlantic Monthly had already decided the story was too long. It wasn't in Saul to mope alone by the telephone. Every morning over breakfast, he diverted me with puns or entertained me with possible subjects for stories, and often he came downstairs to say that he had dreamed up a new way to jumpstart A Case of Love. Why not introduce an eccentric Parisian pianist of the old school who would teach his heroine about love? We were reading and rereading the proofs of A Theft. Saul habitually revises, well beyond the last moment. The ending wasn't right. Too many ideas, not enough movement. He would rework it by day, and each night I would type and retype the latest pages. In the middle of May, we got word that The New Yorker had also turned down his story. But Saul was too busy to be checked by bad news. He was reflecting deeply on what should come next, and the weather wasn't being cooperative. Now, I ought to explain that Saul is extremely weather-sensitive. High-pressure, azure skies, those of late May and early June, have always turned him on. But in that spring of '88, the gloomy rain fell day after day. Saul would light a fire in the kitchen, drink his coffee, and then slosh out to the studio through the blackfly-infested, soppy grass. He wasn't writing, he told me. He was going there to brood. And he added, "That's how I've always done things. You separate yourself from editors, lawyers, publishers. You set down your burdens, and you brood." Our Vermont friends and neighbors, Herb and Libby Hillman, looking to lift our sagging spirits, invited us to dinner. Over Libby's homemade bread and roast chicken, the conversation turned once again to the Jewish question, and Saul introduced an idea we had been debating since his Philadelphia lecture. Should the Jews feel shame over the Holocaust? Is there a particular disgrace in being victimized? I was ferociously opposed to this suggestion. As
we awaited. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.